Well, hello, friends. Welcome to another episode of Unboxing God with me, McCall. There are many different sacred numbers, patterns, sequences, and shapes, but the most significant ones to me, and the ones that I want to unbox today, are the circle, square, and triangle, Fibonacci's sequence and golden ratio. See, I want to help you understand not just the potential meaning of each, but also the correlation between them. With even a modicum of effort, you can train your eye to become aware of these all around you, indoors, outdoors, and who knows? If you want to, you could try my so far ridiculously successful experiment of learning to believe in the Waldo of my own understanding. You could even attribute all these to God. Just as, you know, sort of a one day at a time kind of thing. That dang woo-woo slope is a slippery one indeed. The belief that God created the universe according to some geometric plan has super ancient origins. Sacred geometry is a concept that identifies specific shapes or proportions and assigns a sacred or mystical significance to them. It's a search to identify and point out the apparent order that we see in the universe. Ancient Egyptians believed that geometry provided a path to a clearer understanding of the divine plan. Herodotus, the father of history and a native Greek, stated in 500 BCE, "Now, let me talk more of Egypt, for it has a lot of admirable things, and what one sees there is superior to any other country." The monuments left behind by the ancient Egyptians are universally marveled around the world. Sacred geometry would claim it's because they're proportionally harmonious. Well, I agree. Plutarch attributed belief in sacred geometry to Plato, writing that Plato said God geometricizes continually. In more modern times, just a couple hundred years back, the mathematician Carl Friedrich Gauss adapted that quote, saying God arithmetizes. As late as Johannes Kepler, a belief in the geometric underpinnings of the cosmos persisted among many scientists. You can see evidence of sacred ratios and geometric figures as used to design much of the ancient Egyptian and ancient Indian and Greek and Roman architecture. I mean, medieval European cathedrals are steeped in this stuff. For instance, did you know most of the famous cathedrals in this world have a round stained glass window? Well, if you took that window's wall and laid it very carefully onto the ground, the center rosette of that stained glass window would hit the center of the altar precisely. So, do you think that's an accident? The point is, throughout history, humanity has recognized patterns and relationships in geometry that are uncanny in their appearance throughout the natural world. And we've often sought to incorporate and express those very same patterns and relationships in our own structures, to somehow honor the divine, but also to become closer to the divine, to be more divine ourselves. After all, I'm pretty sure the Tower of Babel used an awful lot of geometry. Last week, I shared my conviction that when I feel stuck between any two choices, a type of urgency and panic sets in. I begin to build judgment values into almost any binary decision. They become this dichotomy, and there are literally rules to dichotomies. Dramatic ones. First of all, everything must belong to one part or the other. That's jointly exhaustive. And nothing can belong simultaneously to both parts. Mutually exclusive. So Wikipedia says that two parts of a dichotomy are jointly exhaustive and mutually exclusive. But I say Dichotomies are exclusive and exhausting. 2, become polar opposites. And suddenly there's not just one better option, but rather one's gotta be right. And therefore, the other is wrong. And here I am, stuck in the middle with you, and filled with urgent indecision, stress, fear, often even anger. Just praying the serenity prayer for wisdom to know the damn difference. Exhausting. I've tried my go-to favorite tool of self-help, imagery. I pictured myself as this elephant balancing on this beach ball, sometimes walking a tightrope, but like a million feet in the air at first. And then slowly, I gradually came to imagine a higher power holding one end of my elephant paw. Do elephants have paws? And then the worldwide fellowship and family and friends holding the other. And it would help me balance on this beach ball. But still, I felt rocky. So I turned the tightrope into a 2x4 that you'd see at a preschooler's playground or something, with a little kid navigating it. And it wasn't 1,000,000,000 feet in the air, just a few inches off the ground. But I'd still teeter and sway, just grabbing at slogans and the phone for outreach calls to use as some sort of a long stick to help me maintain something akin to balance. And granted, that really did help a lot. But even after a year of this daily practice, I never really felt the confidence of sure footing. Plus, the work regularly left my mental muscles pretty sore. How I struggle with the effort of finding balance between any two things. My solution, as I mentioned last week, wahoo. We always have other options. Whenever I find myself anxious and indecisive and can detect some binary decision that I think I have to make and have to make now, I try to reason out with someone else and Waldo some possible third option. An additional selection to the proverbial choices on my menu.
3 is a magic number.
Yes, sometimes it is. Just adding that one number. Extra option is enough to settle my mind. And then my feeble attempts to balance transform into the much more serene work of finding safety in the center. And for me, centering is stable. You can chillax in the center. And the more points, or menu items, from which I have to choose, the better. The easier it is for me not to get distracted by or tempted into that more dangerous diametrical thinking. So, let's start with every option available, with all the points, infinite points, really, with a circle. When we unboxed the self, we discussed the Freudian idea of ego, id, and superego. We also talked about Carl Jung's idea of the soul, the psyche, and the self. And I described that idea with the simple image that Jung used to visually illustrate his concept of the self. First, a circle. And then, in the center, another circle. A tiny dot. And the entire circle makes up the total self, where the small circular dot in the middle represents the ego. Ironically, or perhaps with zero irony and much great intent, Jung wasn't original. The Egyptian hieroglyphics for the cosmic creative force, Ra, the sun god? You guessed it, a little dot in the center of a circle. So the circle symbolically represents the absolute, or undifferentiated unity. Pretty much the opposite of a binary, right? And whether a seed, an egg, an atom, every form is born from a circle. It's the perfect, never-ending curve that's known around the world as a symbol of unity. The one. The universal whole. Circles feature prominently in mandalas, you know, those trippy and often intricate geometric drawings or diagrams, they're pretty common in a bunch of Eastern spiritual traditions. Mandalas fascinated Carl Jung. He defined them as magic circles, containing certain design motifs that he found to have a universal nature across cultures and across time, whether they are the transiently created mandalas from Tibet, sand paintings from the American Southwest, or illustrations from ancient, medieval, even Renaissance works. Jung firmly believed that his mandalas were cryptograms of the state of the self as it was on the day the mandala was created. And so he drew them every single day for a long time. He'd examine them for meaning, to shed light on any internal imbalances. He was sure that one of the most important functions of those magic circles was to bring order out of chaos. As Jung wrote in The Psychology of the Transference, even in Western religious practices, we see the circle as a symbol of completeness and perfect being is a widespread expression for heaven, sun, and God. It also expresses the primordial image of man, he wrote, and the soul.
The past and the present and the future, faith and hope and charity, the heart and the brain and the body give you three as a magic number.
All right, now let's talk about the square. So, if a circle is heaven and the divine, then a square, with its sharp corners and straight, ruler-made lines, is Earth. It's our world, the material 3D reality we call home. It's the compass versus the ruler. Speaking of compasses and rulers, I want to introduce you to Devon. She came through in a pinch to talk to me about all things numeric, geometric, and esoteric. Devon's going to be joining us throughout this whole episode, maybe even the next, to help illuminate some of the connections that I can feel but can't quite articulate. And the most Waldo thing of it all, she is a Freemason. No, you heard that right. See, whenever I even think of a compass and a ruler, I immediately think of a big G in the middle because there's a Freemason lodge right near where I live, here in Los Angeles. Now, Devon doesn't belong to this lodge. She lives in San Diego. However, Freemasons are men. Devon is a transgender woman. And as of the summer of 2018, as long as you were initiated while you still identified as a male, you're a brother. Once a fraternal brother, always a fraternal brother. She also gave me a wealth of Masonic knowledge, friends. She explained to me that there's only really three things she can't share, and she didn't. But we'll be posting the entire interview through Patreon over the upcoming hiatus. Oh, yes, by the way, we only have one more episode before we're taking a break. Over that break, I will be pitching this show to networks. So now is the time to share it. Please let them see a growth in numbers, that there's people listening and following along. It's not too heady or too simple or too 12-step, maybe too dramatic, but that's me.
My name's Devon Dufour Casper. I'm transgender, male to female. Been involved in esoteric and all kinds of interesting, shall we say, literature and knowledge ever since I was a kid. I got interested in everything from astrology and astronomy as a boy and mathematics all the way up until witchcraft, Wiccan, all kinds of alchemy, all kinds of esoteric reading involving all kinds of number sequences, whether it's 3, 5, and 7, and some of the cosmic significances of certain numbers and certain reasons why they're used by certain organizations. And like you said in your opening, you start looking for this stuff. It's literally everywhere. Once your eyes are opened to it, it becomes very hard to ignore all of the little things. You'll go into a building and you'll see symbols and symbology everywhere because of how it's built. Companies use it for certain reasons to denote certain things, whether you're talking about pyramids or obelisks or all-seeing eyes, eagles. You see all these symbols everywhere, and all of a sudden they start to take on whole new meanings once you start to actually look at them in a different way. God, or as some people refer to him, especially people in the esoteric realm, refer to him as the great architect of the universe. When you deal with that and you take that aspect, instead of referring to him as God or even referring to him as him, but you refer to that entity as the great architect of the universe, you start to realize that, hey, this wasn't necessarily, yeah, some of it might have been by accident, but some of it looks very much by design.
It takes three legs to make a tripod or to make a table stand. It takes three wheels to make a vehicle called a tricycle.
Hey friends, this is Harper, McCall's daughter, coming at you from our makeshift quarantine recording studio. Sorry to interrupt your deep spiritual listening, but a girl's gotta make sure her mama brings home the bacon, so I'm here to tell you guys about Anchor. Anchor is a podcast recording app, which is free, and ain't nothing cheaper than free. It has a variety of creation tools that let you record, edit, and customize your podcast from your mobile device or computer. Anchor will even distribute your podcast for you on Spotify, Apple Podcasts, all those listening apps, so you can feel like a professional podcaster. The icing on the cake? Every time someone listens to your podcast, you make like a whole half a cent. So thank you for those shiny new 99-cent store shoelaces episode 1 provided me. Rate, review, and share Unboxing God so we can afford the other shoelace. But most importantly, download the free Anchor app or go to anchor.fm to get started today.
Ancient geometers proposed a mathematical problem. Draw a square with only a straight edge and compass, and using a finite number of steps that has the same area as a given circle. The problem was called squaring the circle. In other words, draw any circle you want, of any size, and then only with a ruler and a compass, create a square with the exact same area. And it's got to be done with a finite number of steps. So the problem can't go on and on forever, like dividing 1 by 3 using decimals results in that infinite string of 0.33333333. Well, theoretically, the problem is simple. The area of a circle is calculated by multiplying the square of the circle's radius by the number pi, commonly represented as 3.14, right? That's pi r squared. Don't lose me here. Stay with me. If you measure the distance from the center point of the circle to any point on the edge of that circle, you get the radius. And now imagine the length of a spoke on a toy wheel that's 2 inches. To square it, we multiply it by itself, right? 2 times 2 is 4. Then we multiply that by pi, 3.14, to find the area of the circle. So to keep it really simple, 2 times 3 is 6. All right, now we're looking for a square with an area of 6. That should be easy enough, right? To calculate the area of a square, all we do is measure the length of any one side of that square, and we square it. That is, we multiply it by itself, like we did with the circle. But since we already have the area we want, then we're actually trying to find the length that the sides need to be. We're interested in the square root of the circle's area, which was 6. And the square root of 6 happens to be 2.44948. Perfect! We did it! We solved the ancient problem. Except, there's a catch. Squaring the circle was proved to be impossible in 1882. How? How did we get to a solution to an impossible problem? Well, remember that little shortcut when I simplified pi to 3? You can't exactly do that in math. because of a thing called amplified errors. Consider the simple life maxim that little becomes big. Now get your mind out of the gutter. It means to save up a little bit of money each week. After a while, it becomes a lot of money. Well, the same is true of mistakes in math. If you make a tiny error at the start of the equation, by the time you get to your answer, you are way off base. Since I am a huge fan of imagery, imagine it this way. If you want to shoot a rocket up to Neptune, and your navigation is off by just a few tiny degrees, nobody's going to notice during blastoff, right? Or maybe even as it passes through the Earth's atmosphere out into space. But by the time it's supposed to be approaching its destination, the rocket is going to be millions of miles off course. Okay, let's get back to the original problem then, and leave pi as it is. Let's simplify the problem another way. Now let's have the length of the spoke, or the radius, be 1 instead of 2, because 1 squared is 1, and 1 times pi is pi. So the area of the circle is pi. That seems simple. Now all we've got to do is find the square root of pi. Therein lies the problem, friends. If you can remember back to middle school math, you probably had at least some exposure to pi. Maybe you were given an assignment, or extra credit, for calculating pi to the 100th decimal point, or seeing which student could memorize pi's decimal representation to the most digits. Well, all of those exercises are meant to reinforce the fact that pi is what we call an irrational number. I've spent a lot of time acting irrationally. Makes sense I'd be attracted to it. See, it has no completely accurate fractional representation. We do use 22 over 7, but really that's just a close approximation, and it results in an infinite string of decimals, just like 1/3 is 0.333333333 repeating. So, pi doesn't have a square root, at least not one that can be calculated in a finite number of steps. It would technically require an infinite number of steps, and anything infinite sure does feel irrational. So, the solution falls apart, and we see that we did not, in fact, solve the unsolvable problem from thousands of years ago. Well, if pi is irrational, then phi is completely senseless. It's often referred to as the most irrational number ever. In order to properly unbox phi, we've got to lay some groundwork. And let's start with the Fibonacci sequence. Fibonacci popularized the usage of Arabic numerals, the ones we still use today, and made famous a set of numbers called the Fibonacci sequence. Each number in the sequence is the sum of the previous two numbers. So starting with 0 and then 1. 0 plus 1 is 1. Then 1 plus 1 is 2. And 1 plus 2 is 3. 2 plus 3 is 5. 3 plus 5 is 8. And so on. The first 10 numbers in the sequence are 0, 1, 1, 2, 3, 5, 8, 13, 21, 34. Now, put a pin in Fibonacci, because we're going to come back to that. But to understand phi fully, we also have to examine the golden ratio and how it relates to that sequence of Fibonacci's. The golden ratio in mathematics is a very special number. It's usually symbolized using phi after the 21st letter of the Greek alphabet. Okay, so what exactly is the golden ratio? It is, in mathematical terms, a comparison of any two aspects that leads us to proportion them in an ideal way. Let's just call it 1 to 1.618, which is a little bit more than 1 to 1.5, right? And it appears naturally all over, starting with your body. For example, the length of your hand has the value of 1, let's say. then the combined length of your hand plus your forearm has the approximate value of 1.618. Measure your lower body. You'll find the same. If the foot's 1, the length of the foot and the shin is 1.618. Have you ever heard of the Adonis Index? It's about building the perfect body, like Adonis. It says, if you want to build a body that is attractive in any type of wardrobe and is noticeable even across the room, you need to optimize your Adonis Index. You need to develop your shoulders so they're broad compared to your waist. The perfect dimensions are, you guessed it, in line with the golden ratio. In addition to the human body, the golden ratio can be found represented in all kinds of natural expressions. Almost every flower's petals are equal to a number in the Fibonacci sequence, and the golden ratio appears in the arrangement of those petals. The seed heads on a sunflower migrate outwards from the center in a perfect representation of Fibonacci's spiral. Similarly, the pods of a pine cone display a golden ratio pattern as well. Seashells, hurricanes, even our own Milky Way galaxy all present as Fibonacci spirals, revealing the golden ratio. You can see patterns appearing all over just by paying attention. The fascination with Leonardo da Vinci's famous depiction of the Vitruvian Man is not only in the mass consciousness, but it's inspired artists and mathematicians for the last 500 years to a deeper inquiry of who we are. Allowing for the thickness of a pencil point, Leonardo da Vinci's classic drawing is a fraction short of the perfect golden ratio. Our physical form encodes this divine mathematics down to the strands of our DNA. Thus, the terrestrial meets the celestial. Many people consider it true. Really, there's no evidence either for or against the idea that Leonardo purposefully included the golden ratio in his drawing of the Vitruvian Man, but I don't know. I like living in the mystery.
Don't even get me started on some of that stuff. Part of the reason why he did some of that stuff and part of the reason why some of that stuff was done was basically to protect themselves against being called heretics, lunatics. A lot of these people did work for the church or they were intellectuals around the church, so they couldn't afford to literally be questioned by the church and lose their livelihood or their lives. So a lot of this was done very, at a minimum, tongue-in-cheek, and at a complete maximum, completely being hidden. A lot of people say a lot of Da Vinci's works and paintings, they carry tons and tons of hidden meanings. I mean, you can't actually walk up to them and measure them, but there's people that have measured some of the differences and the way the position of people are in a lot of his works. And you start to understand that there's all these mathematical equations that come up in not just the Vitruvian Man and not just the Mona Lisa.
Oh, no, but all in his sketchbooks. Back till he was like 7 years old, he was obsessed with circles and invented the machine that cranks water uphill.
Yeah, with, exactly.
Based on a circle. I mean, he was mathematically way advanced. Yeah, I love Leonardo's story.
And that's part of the whole, if you want to call it that way, the charm of him was that he was very much a man of the world. He didn't look at things the same way. He was one of those people that looked completely outside the box. There's stuff that he said that he would literally dream about and then he'd go write them down the next day. And so a lot of this stuff he said would come to him in visions and in dreams. And so was he solving problems just through a dream or was he actually tapping into hidden knowledge that's out there in the cosmos? It do make for an interesting subject when you discuss him.
It's just neat to explore, right?
Exactly. And that's why I have so much fun with it.
Supposedly, sacred geometry brings about certain effects, things like healing, harmonizing, and rebalancing on every level. It connects the inner with the outer and unites it all. The Platonic solids are thought of as the building blocks of all sacred geometry of the universe, and they were taught in the Greek mystery schools 2,500 years ago. These are the tetrahedron, hexahedron, octahedron, and you get the point. But the triangle is the symbol that underlies all of them. Triangle symbolizes balance, harmony, completion, rising upwards. It elevates us to a higher consciousness. The triangle represents the union of our body, mind, and spirit. If you're listening to Unboxing God, undoubtedly you're curious. And if you're the curious sort, then you know that triangles are the strongest structural shape in engineering. But do you know why? It all comes down to compression and tension. Stack triangles side by side, put some facing up and others facing down, and you essentially create a network of compression and tension that creates maximum stability by distributing that force of weight all throughout the sides of these triangles. The end result is that triangles end up supporting everything, from a pup tent to suspension bridges to the tallest skyscrapers in the world. If three is a magic number, then I think it only makes sense the physical embodiment of three as a triangle is also a magic shape. All right, now let's put a couple of those shapes together. You put a triangle in a circle, and you have the symbol of Alcoholics Anonymous. Well, that particular symbol has its origins in many secret societies. One, tied to Masonry, used it to, quote, impart and convey its teachings to initiates. Not exactly sure how a symbol imparts a lot, but it does represent very meaningful things to me personally. In a book called Alcoholics Anonymous Comes of Age, which is published by AA, Bill Wilson says of that symbol, that we have chosen this symbol is perhaps no mere accident. The priests and seers of antiquity regarded the circle enclosing the triangle as a means of warding off spirits of evil. And AA's circle of recovery, unity, and service has certainly meant all that to us, and much more. That triangle in a circle not only tells me I can find recovery through the steps, unity through the traditions, and service through the concepts, it also reminds me of my threefold ideal: to keep my head above my feet and my heart in between. So I keep my thoughts mindfully focused on whatever it is that I am doing right now in the moment. And usually, my heart, well, it's kind of amazing, but it'll usually fall in line. From the moment of the Big Bang, the universe has been expanding. And from the time of early humans, we've been using images, shapes, and eventually numbers to represent our understanding of this incredible world around us. It seems the more scientists study, the more they find out how much there still is that we don't know. Whether it's a focus on the smallest particles in quantum physics or the endless boundaries of the universe itself, it's unlikely that we'll ever really achieve a theory of everything. There's just too much out there. But we can clearly see the patterns of shapes, numbers, and natural phenomena that inspires us to keep striving. Whether the ultimate answer is in the great architect or just a series of extremely unlikely coincidences, there's so much to consider in awe and wonder, which is exactly where I think I'll pick this up next week. Until then, this is McCall with Unboxing God. Bye. Three, it's a magic number. Yes, it is. It's a magic number. Recovery, unity, and service. That's in the circle, too. Yesterday, today, and tomorrow. Threes are all over if you look for them.